When something's on fire, you know it's serious. Hey everyone, Doug here from B&H. We are at NAB 2019. It is day two now, and I have to say, there's always a story at NAB. Every year, there's some theme that you'll notice every day. Now, the story this year happens to be story. But if you look around, you'll see another story, and that is the one of 8K. Now, do we really need to know about 8K at this point? I'm not sure. I want to find some experts, and they're going to tell me what they think of 8K. All right, everyone. So I have Cliff here from Sharp. All right, here we have Jason from Blackmagic. I am here with one of B&H's very own. We're here for 8K. So I just want to know, is the world ready for 8K?
Well, 8K is certainly coming. As a lot of us know, the Tokyo Olympics in Japan is going to be broadcast in 8K, so Sharp and a lot of manufacturers are already selling 8K TVs in anticipation of that event, which is only about 6 months away right now.
If there's any company that knows video and technicality, I trust you guys. Why now? Why 8K right now?
When everyone was very, very established and happy with HD, you know, years ago, we were one of the first companies to really heavily push 6G SDI for 4K 30 and then 12G SDI for 4K 60. And at the end of the day, what we realized is even if people didn't want a switcher or a HyperDeck or any kind of unit that necessarily was ready for 4K now because everyone was doing 4K, it was still a really great HD product and even a standard definition product. But when the time came to upgrade everything to 4K, the idea was that you get this piece and that piece and that piece. By the time everything is standardized and normalized, you already have everything.
What would you say are the immediate benefits to 8K?
Well, you certainly have higher resolution, but at the moment, like you said, at the media benefit, most people don't have 8K displays. It's a very rare occasion that somebody would have something on 8K. And so the benefit of actually shooting today in 8K are several. One, it's future-proofing, right? So down the road, when everybody's viewing everything in 8K, you're going to have a nice high-quality video, right? So as you look back in time, the video quality will look wonderful.
For me, one of the advantages is that when you work in these higher resolutions like 8K, you can really do a lot of recomposing your shot and reframing your shot and getting things that might have been really hard to get without really expensive long telephoto lenses, for example, because you can actually reframe that 8K footage and really punch in and get a much better zoom out of the shot without losing quality.
You could shoot a wider frame, right? And if your intention is to then reframe it to 4K or HD, you have a lot of space to play around with, right? You could do a virtual multi-camera shoot like we're doing today with one camera shooting 8K, and then I could reframe in on you, on me, and I'm still in 4K.
Like if we take the new ATEM Constellation 8K switcher, sure, it's quad 4K to make one 8K signal, so we've got 10 8K inputs here, but each 12G SDI input also acts as its own 4K input, so what we also have is we doubled the size of our largest switcher this year at NAB, and now we have a 40 input 4K switcher at the same time, and each one of those inputs has its own standard conversion. So yeah, sure, it's a 10 input 8K switcher, and if you want to switch 8K now, you can.
This whole space here that you have, I see you have 8K monitors, you have edit bays here, multiple editing software. What exactly is this room about beyond just 8K? What can you talk about though? What are some of the challenges? And also, what's all of this doing to address that?
We talk about it as the 8K ecosystem. So what we're showing here today is also the ability to capture 8K in our 8K studio right next door, move over here into our 8K editing workstation area where we have multiple computers with various configurations, including PCs and Macs. We have a Grass Valley system here behind us. And then we're showing folks what are the tips and tricks and techniques of managing 8K, because it's not just a simple application where you sort of drop the files in like you do with an HD.
It's massive.
You're going from 4K to 8K. It's not twice as much processing power. It's four times as much processing power. So what we're showing here is a graphics card that's running, all of this footage is running off of the GPU. And so you can see, this is the CPU. The CPU is not really doing much here. You can see.
Oh yeah, wow, yeah, that's 13%, okay. Yeah.
This is all 8K footage off of the VistaVision.
Wow, and is that playing back from a RAW file?
This is actually, this is Red Code RAW.
Wow, so it's able to debayer right in almost real time, right?
And you can see here, I can even make my changes. Watch, just so I can show you that it's no joke. This is red code raw.
What would you say someone can do to prepare themselves for 8K production? If there's like one thing,
I would make sure that you have a good solid state storage on board, as well as good high speed USB Type C interface, so you can leverage the low cost external storage which is available today.
The first obviously is DaVinci Resolve, and even in the free version, you can still work up to a 16K by 16K canvas area. So you're more than ready for 4K video editing, and in DaVinci Resolve Studio, the paid version for $299, you can export file sizes up to 16K by 16K. So technically, you could say Resolve is a 16K product.
If you can get an onboard GPU, that's great. A lot of manufacturers now are recognizing people like to be mobile and use a laptop. There are several external or eGPUs that are available on the market. So you really need a good processor, something probably with between 8 and 10 cores, right, is optimal. Select a GPU as high quality of a GPU that you can afford.
Maybe next year. Maybe next year we'll be talking about 16K.
I don't maybe some pixels are too many. I don't know. We'll see.
Do you look forward to using 8K?
Sure. And can I take the mic? Is that easier?
No.
You get a sharper, more detailed picture when you start from 8K and you bring the image down to like a 4K or 5K timeline. You're also going to notice that the noise itself, and all video has an inherent amount of noise,
right,
that is very, very small when you take that 8K image and shrink it down. So it's actually going to look a lot cleaner. So your video is going to look amazingly clean and detailed. And that's another advantage of the 8K.
One of the other products that we have that we're really excited about is the Teranex Mini. SDI to HDMI 8K. We added a monitor calibration function inside the Teranex Mini. So you can plug a calibration probe into the Teranex Mini, and the box, the Teranex Mini box, will actually generate a 3D LUT for a calibration LUT for your monitor based on whatever monitor you're using. Yeah, so it's a really affordable way for DITs and colorists and post-production facilities to start thinking about how they're going to start getting ready for an 8K pipeline if it comes down the line.
And that is what I want to hear. So, would you say, is 8K here to stay? Is the world ready for 8K?
Is the world ready?
If we saw anything and learned anything from the jump from HD to 4K, it's that, well, everything is done in HD now and nothing's really done in standard def. Most places are outfitted for 4K. So maybe we're just ending our world where, you know, everything might be done in 4K in a few years, but everyone's also ready for 8K. So we'll have to see what happens in the future.
It may have surprised a lot of folks because a lot of people were trying to catch up with 4K, and technology is moving so fast now.
It's all moving so fast.
That 8K technology is achievable, even though a lot of people have not upgraded it to 4K.
I don't think on the delivery end of things, I think we're a long way from that. I think 8K is an acquisition format. You have to look at it as an acquisition format. And it's going to up the cost of your production because you're going to need to have additional storage on set. You're going to need to have additional servers. There's a lot of things you got to factor in because, yeah, it is a lot more data.
If I'm going out and buying some new equipment, I would probably do a little bit of homework. Most of the manufacturers will give recommendations about hardware requirements.
The fact that we can actually do this now speaks volumes as far as it becoming a standard at some point.
And we're right back where we started. The story of 8K, or maybe 16K, according to some people. I know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna tell my own story. Won't you join me?